Hi everybody, this video is the second part of a series of three videos on lessor accounting. In my first video, I covered the concept as well as the accounting treatment of a finance lease. In this video, I will be taking up solved examples of these finance leases. Two solved examples, one on accounting for a finance lease by a manufacturer dealer and the other one accounting for a finance lease by a regular lessor. Hi, I'm Ranjini. Through my videos, I try to simplify complex accounting topics to help you understand them better. So before we actually go into the solved examples, let us quickly recap on the accounting treatment. If your lessor is a manufacturer dealer, then in order to recognize a finance lease, they will first debit net investment in lease. The credit is to the carrying value of the leased asset. And finally, they will recognize profit in the profit and loss account by recognizing sales revenue and debiting the cost of goods sold. All of this will become clear to you when we solve the example. Next, we come to the question of the initial direct cost. It's very simple. A manufacturer dealer simply expenses out the initial direct cost. Now, once the initial recognition is done, we have subsequent measurement. What do? They recognize the lease payment received and they split it into two parts. One is interest and the other one is the net investment in lease, which is the repayment of the principal amount. All right. So now let's go to the actual example. Okay, let us read the question now. Mr. H leases a car to ply as a taxi from Mr. D for 5 years. The car is not specialized and is expected to have other uses for Mr. D after the lease term. At the commencement of the lease, the car's fair value is $100,000, carrying amount is $80,000, and it has a balanced economic life of 11 years. Mr. D incurs an initial direct cost of $5,000 relating to the lease. The estimated residual value of the car at the end of 5 years is $50,000, of which Mr. H guarantees $40,000. The implicit rate of interest is 4%. Mr. H pays Mr. D $14,400 every year at the end of the year. Mr. H also agrees to pay 10% of the cab fare that he earns in each year. Cab fare earned in year 1 is $50,000 and year 2 is $78,000. Mr. H does not have the option to extend the lease term or purchase the car at the end of the lease term. Assuming that Mr. D is a dealer, what are the accounting entries that will be passed in the first 2 years in the big books of Mr. D as per IFRS 16? Alright, let us make a short summary of the question to help us understand it better. We know that the lessee is Mr. H. And the lessor is Mr. D. The lease term, 5 years. At the commencement of the lease, the car's fair value is 100,000. Carrying amount, 80,000. Economic life, 11 years. Initial direct cost, $5,000. Estimated residual value is 50,000, of which Mr. H guarantees 40,000. So guaranteed residual value is 40,000. Unguaranteed residual value is 10,000. Implicit rate of return is 4%. The lease rental is 14,400 every year, paid at the end of the year. Now there is also a variable rental that is based on usage, which is 10% of cab fare. So there is no option to extend the lease or to purchase the car at the end of the lease term. We are saying that Mr. D is a dealer lessor. Okay, let us start solving. What they need is accounting entries for 2 years. So your solution is journal entries. And then we have our working notes here. First, let us identify whether this lease is a finance lease or an operating lease. We do know that the lease term is 5 years. Whereas totally the economic life is 11 years. So it is not even 50%. So it does not cover substantially all of the economic life. They are also saying that the car is not a specialized asset. He does not have the option to extend the lease term or to purchase the asset. Therefore, all indicators is that it is an operating lease. But now let us look at whether the present value of the lease payments covers substantially the fair value of the asset. So our working note one is we are determining whether this lease is a operating lease or a finance lease. The working note is a very familiar one. So now in the year 1 to 5, the annual lease rental is 14,400. The discounting factor, or in this case the annuity factor, at 4% for 5 years, 4.4514. Now I have explained this calculation in detail in another video of mine titled How to Calculate the Present Value. I'm giving the link here as well as in my descriptions. If you do not understand the step, please refer to that video. The discounted cash flow, 64,100. Now in the fifth year, the guaranteed residual value is 40,000. The discounting factor, 0.8218. Totally, the price that is paid by the lessee for this car is 96,972. The fair value of the asset is 100,000. So, 97% of the price is being paid by the lessee. This does cover substantially the total value of the asset, and therefore, we have a finance lease. Alright, so now how do we account for a finance lease when it is a dealer? First of all, we need to calculate the net investment in lease. The net investment in lease is the present value of the lease payments receivable as well as the unguaranteed residual value. Working note 2, we can actually copy paste the initial two rows because this is the present value of the lease payment receivable. Only thing that we need to add here is the unguaranteed residual value, 10,000. The discounting factor we copy from above. So our net investment in lease is 105,190. All right, so now we've got the debit, which is net investment in lease. The credit is easy. We need to derecognize the asset at the carrying value. So let's start the entry. This is year 0, that means at the beginning of the lease. You have net investment in lease. Here we pick it up, 105,190 to car on lease. The carrying value is 80,000. Now, if it was a regular lessor, this is it. The difference between these two would be taken directly to the profit and loss account. But this is no regular lessor. It is a manufacturer dealer. And therefore, we also need to account for sales revenue as well as the cost of goods sold. This will be our working note 3. What is the sales? Sales is lower of the fair value, which we know is 100,000. And the present value of lease payments receivable. In this case, what are the lease payments that they will receive from the lessee? It is only the lease rentals as well as the guaranteed residual value. Will we take into consideration the unguaranteed residual value? No, because it is not going to be paid by the lessee. Will we also take into consideration those variable lease payments? Rental that is 10% of the cab fare? No, these are not going to be taken into any of our calculation. It will only be recorded as another income. So the present value of lease payments receivable, we've actually already calculated it over here. Annual rental and the guaranteed residual value. So yes, the lower of this is 96,972. Now we also calculate this cost of goods sold, which is the carrying value of 80,000 less the present value of unguaranteed residual value. That is 8218 and the 71,782. Let's record it here. You have cost of goods sold debit 71,782 and you have two sales revenue 96,972. Let's see if the debit equals the credit. The debit total is 176,972 The credit total is also 176,972. The entry is done. The sales revenue and COGS will be taken to P&L account and the profit will automatically get recorded. The next entry that is passed at the inception is the payment of the initial direct cost. So you have to bank, which is 5,000, and that will be directly taken to the P&L. Okay, now we go to the next working note, and that is where we calculate the division of the lease repayment into interest and the principal repayment. This is a very familiar working note. Here we, in the 5 years, the opening balance will be the net investment in lease. The interest earned is going to be 4%. We receive 14,400, and the closing balance, opening balance plus interest minus repayments. Closing balance is the opening balance of the next year, and everything else stays. All of this gets copied right till the end. What you will notice is that at the end of the fifth year, you should get the residual value of 50,000. Okay, so now we are at the end of the year. The lessee pays us two amounts. One is the annual lease rental of 14,400, but he also gives us 10% of his cab fare. So 10% of 50,000 is 5,000, right? So he gives us 14,400 plus 5,000. What is the interest? We take it from our working note. You know, there's a variable income from lease. So two income from lease, 5,000, which is the 10% of actual usage. And then the balancing figure is the net investment in lease. Finally, we take the income and the expenses to the P&L account. So you have interest account, debit, income from lease account, initial direct cost is expensed out. Let's fill in these amounts. Interest account is 4207. Income from lease is 5,000. Initial direct cost is 5,000. To P&L account 420. Now that we're done at the end of first year, we go to end of second year. We can copy paste these entries. Bank account, this time you get your 14,400 plus 10% of the cab fare. It is 7,800. The interest from the interest working note. The income from lease, we know, is 7,800. And we will take to the P&L account, interest account, debit, 3,800. Income from lease, which is 7,800. There is no initial direct cost to P&L account. So that's our solution. At the beginning of the year, we recognize the lease. At the end of the first year, we recognize the income from the lease. At the end of the second year also, we recognize the income from the lease. Okay, that unexpectedly brings us to the end of this video. At the beginning, I had planned to do another example of lessor accounting of finance lease with you, where the lessor is not a dealer or manufacturer. But this video is already too long, so I think I will need to make a separate video for that. Before I conclude, I want to give a disclaimer relating to the accounting of the initial direct cost. Like I said in my earlier video, I looked through all my sources and I could not find a solid example which showed me the accounting of the initial direct cost by a lessor. So the accounting that I've shown here is purely based on my understanding. The same goes for variable lease payment based on usage. Before you apply this in real life, please do talk to your chartered accountant or your accounts teacher. Also, if you have a different interpretation, please do put it in the comment section below so that I can also learn. Thank you very much for watching this video. In case you have any comments, any queries, any suggestions for improvement, kindly put them in the comment section. I hope you found this video helpful. Bye.